Good morning and Merry Christmas. Oh my goodness, a bunch of Grinches out there. Let's try that again. Good morning, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Hey, there we go. It is good to see you guys this morning. We've already been to Florida and back this week. And we tried to bring a little warm weather back with us, but I don't think it's going to stay, but we'll be all right. So I hope you guys are looking forward to a wonderful Christmas. Always look forward to this time of year. And Christmas Eve, Christmas time with the family, and it's going to be a real joy. Just a few quick announcements, and we'll move on into the service. Lottie Moon Offerings doing very well. Our goal of 1,500, we're at 1,371. So we've almost met our goal, and we'll be collecting through January the 28th. A reminder that tonight our candlelight service will be at 5 p.m. So I invite you to be back here this evening for that. We look forward to it. Next Sunday morning, there is no Sunday school, and service will actually be at 10 a.m. in the Life Center. And we'll have a pancake breakfast over there, time of fellowship, and looking forward to kicking off the new year. Those who might be interested in helping us make a bunch of pancakes, if you'll be there about 8:30 in the morning, and if you're interested in helping, let me know, and we'll flip some pancakes, and we'll look forward to a good time. So I'm excited. Again, it is Christmas time. I love this time of year. We'll be finishing our Advent wreath this morning. And I've got a guest family. Y'all may or may not know them. So if you don't, make sure you get around to shaking their hands and introducing yourself. But I'm going to invite the Henderson family to come up this morning and help us with our candle lighting.
On the last Sunday of Advent, a fourth candle on the Advent wreath is lit. Traditionally, this purple candle has been called the angel candle, or candle of love, and represents the peace that Christ's birth brings to earth. As it is Christmas Eve, we also reflect on the newly placed white candle in the middle, the Christ candle, representing the pure Lamb of God who has come to take away the sins of the world, which is lit on Christmas Eve, if the lighter will light them. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife. For that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife. But he knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Matthew 1:18-25.
It was because of the love of God that the Father sent his Son, Jesus. He loves his creation and desires to be restored to a right relationship with us. He is the one who first loved us, as we are reminded in Romans that his love was demonstrated by Christ's death on the cross, even while we were sinners and enemies of God. How should we respond to his love and the gift of his Son being born of a woman 2,000 years ago? The Apostle John gives us the answer in 1 John chapter 4. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another.
Let's pray. Dear God, you've given us the greatest gift ever, the ultimate sacrifice of love, your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for your unconditional love that offers us grace in the midst of our sin. As we lit this fourth candle today, we're reminded of your boundless love. May the light of this candle shine forth as a symbol of the love you have shown us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us show the same love to those around us. Let us be conduits of kindness and forgiveness. Fill us with your Holy Spirit who guides us as we wait for the return of your Son. Be with those that are struggling and those that are hurting. God, give them the love that can only come straight from your throne. Thank you for loving us so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. It's good to see y'all here. Maybe there's still some presents left to be packed and maybe some cooking left to be done, but that's not why we're here this morning. We're here because God loved us so much to send us such a wonderful Savior, and he's the source of all our joy that we feel. So I want to invite y'all to stand with us, and we'll get into some singing here.
Joy to the world.
Of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. If you've been with us for the last few weeks, Jonathan's been sharing with us some of the prophecies throughout Scripture of the coming Messiah. It goes way back to the garden when God cursed the serpent and promised that He would send the seed of the woman to crush the head of Satan, deliver us from the power of sin and death. He showed us a few weeks ago how the sacrificial system of Israel all was symbolically foreshadowing the coming of a great high priest who would offer Himself for the sins of the world. And it's just such an epic story dealing with the fate of nations and kings and powers and principalities in the heavenly places. And yet when the fullness of time had come and the great culmination of history arrived, it was in a little town called Bethlehem, maybe a little bit like Mount Hope, and this baby who was born in a stable. And that's just why we celebrate this 2,000 years later. It's such a surprising, wonderful story, and so that's why we're singing this morning. Let's sing Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Jesus, born to set thy people free from our sins and fears, release us. Let us find our rest in thee, Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth. Oh,
Special songs. I want to invite you to have a seat, make yourselves comfortable, and we'll put on a little bit of a show for you. I hope these songs are new.
Martha.
For the gift that you gave us on that first Christmas, the gift of hope, of peace, of joy, of salvation. God, it's the gift that you've wanted to give us from the garden, the gift of your presence come down to be with us, to be like us, something that we could touch and see and feel. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for what he did for us. Lord, I ask that each person here find some time this Christmas to get past the presents and the company and the food and all the things that we love and enjoy, but to see past those things to this story that you wrote for us, this story of history, this great event that took place 2,000 years ago. I hope that this story would just impact each and every person here in a new way, in a special way this Christmas. Father, I pray that you would speak to us this morning through our pastor. Lord, and that each person here, that we would just go out these doors and have such a Merry Christmas this year. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
We'll finish up our series on the prophecies about Jesus this morning. And I want to make sure that everybody knows that if you purchased a poinsettia, thank you so much for allowing us to be able to decorate our sanctuary with them. Please take yours on the way home when you leave this morning, please. Please take those. I've got several notes from folks telling me to remember to remind everybody, please take your poinsettias home with you. I want to talk this morning briefly about the prophecies of the resurrection. And I want to ask you, have you ever longed for something for a very long time? You've wanted something. You just can't wait. It may be when we were little fellers and fellerettes, we just could not wait for Christmas. Maybe we just could not wait till we got married, or we just could not wait till we got home, or that car we wanted, or that job that we wanted, or to make our hair do that goose thing without standing up in the back. There's something that we've looked forward to for a long time. And what we've talked about so far this month is what the Old Testament said about something and what was fleshed out in the New Testament. Today I want to change your thinking, and I want to put in your mind what's been prophesied in your life this time, and then I want you to think about what it's going to look like when it actually happens. And I want to ask you this morning, what does the resurrection mean to you? Now this is Christmas. This is a time when we're giving gifts. This is a time when we're getting gifts. This is a time when we're stressing over what kind of gift we ought to get. And I'm ashamed to admit, but I'm not ashamed to admit, that gift cards are beautiful because they're always the right size and they're always the right color. And you can give that to somebody. Whereas my mother, bless her heart, she would buy me a medium shirt for Christmas every year. And I would put it on and the sleeves would come to about there. And I would say, Mama, I'm not six anymore. You're going to have to buy extra large longs to fit me. Oh gosh, it looked like it fits you on the hanger. And I said, hold it up to me. A gift card is always the right size. So there's something that you've been looking forward to all your life. And it may be that you're about to get that gift this Christmas. Or maybe you think back when you were a child to a gift that you wanted really, really, really bad, and you finally were able to get that and how awesome it was. I want you to think this morning about the resurrection of Christ. And I want you to think about the resurrection of the church. Because there's going to come a time when we are going to be separated from these walks of life and the Lord is going to take us out of here. The folks in the Old Testament were prophesied too that there was going to come a Messiah, that there was going to be a sacrifice, the end all sacrifice. They were prophesied all those things, and those things happened. You cannot go and find the body of Christ because He only used a borrowed tomb. The bones were never removed because He rose from the dead in the third day and ascended to be with our Father in heaven. What will the resurrection of the church mean to you? And what will it mean to those, if you don't see it, that will see it, of the future generation? It may be that you've got something that was handed down to you from your grandmother or your great-grandfather or your great-great-great, or fill in the blank how far back, and you can look at that and you can hold that and you can say, this has been passed down to me for generations. This means so much to me. Let me ask you, we give something to somebody, will it be passed down for generations, or at some point will it be a 5-cent yard sale item? But salvation is the one thing that you can pass down to the next generation that cannot be stolen. Moths can't eat it, rust cannot corrupt it. And that's what I want us to think about this morning, is the resurrection for the future generations. The first thing about the resurrection, it is coming. It is coming. You can write it down. Turn with me to the book of John chapter 13. There is going to come a time when we are going to be called out. It may be while we're still here. It may be after we slip through the death of the burial. We're going to face that resurrection. And in John chapter 13, Jesus is dealing with this, and He's dealing with this in front of the disciples with the exclusion of Judas, who has already left. And Jesus is trying to explain to the disciples, I am about to leave you. I'm about to experience things that you don't understand, and it has to be that way. And Peter says, I'll go with you wherever you go. There's nothing going to happen to you that won't happen to me. And Jesus says, Peter, you can't go with me. As a matter of fact, you are going to deny me three times. And that's where I want us to start here in John 13, starting in verse 38. And I realize there's a chapter break there. 38 is the last verse of chapter 13. But verse 1 of chapter 14 starts in kind of a funny way if you just pick up there. And you'll see what I'm talking about here in just a minute. Chapters were put in there for us. They weren't put in there originally. So he says, Jesus says unto him, will you lay your life down for my sake? Most assuredly, I say to you, the rooster will not crow until you have denied me three times. Let your heart not be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. And of course, we know Thomas says, I don't understand what you're saying. And Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. But why I wanted us to start at the end of chapter 13 is so we would know why Jesus said in verse 1 of 14, let not your heart be troubled. If we just started with let not your heart be troubled, you may say, well, what have I to be troubled over? What's going on in my life that would cause me this kind of distress? Because even though we deny Him, we are still His. It's important to remember that we're not perfect, and we're never going to be perfect this side of the resurrection. And Jesus knew Peter would betray Him, yet He said, don't let your heart be troubled. So the things that go on in our life when we deny Him daily, and we think we should really be concerned, because how can somebody of my stature betray my Lord and Savior? And Satan's going to say, you're not really saved if you did something like that. God, Jesus Christ in the flesh, says, do not be troubled. Troubled as those who have no hope. Troubled to consider a life of separation from God. That's when you need to be troubled. When you have a gut check that you've never accepted the gift of Jesus Christ. Jesus went to make us a place. A mansion that contains mansions. Now you've got to understand the audience that Jesus is speaking to here. Most of us have a semi-permanent home or a permanent home. We're not nomads like the children of Israel were. We're not living in tents, wandering from place to place, living that nomadic lifestyle. That's what they've always known, and as time has gone on, they've settled down. What Jesus is saying, this will be a personal space within a communal space. You have a place that everybody else will be at that knows the Lord. You're not going to roam anymore. You're not going to have to pick up your tent and go somewhere else. And not only is there a place made for you, Jesus said, but I'm going to come back and take you so you can be where I am, and you'll be with me forever. Jesus said, I'm going to make that place, and I will come back, and I will take you there to be with Jesus, with God, in heaven, in a mansion, inside a mansion, where God's glory is always there. Now, you may ask yourself, what in the world is this going to look like? 1 Corinthians 2:9 says, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. And that's a quote off of Isaiah 64:4. You think you've seen a beautiful flower? You think you've heard some beautiful singing just now? You think you've seen the most awesome sunrise or sunset or the stars or you've experienced something that blew your socks off, that is dumb compared to what God has prepared for us in heaven. And what he's trying to tell us is that you can't work your way there, you can't save your way there, and you can't do your hair away to get you there. Nothing will get you there except faith in Jesus Christ. When the resurrection of the church comes, only the gift of Jesus Christ will add you to that number. So it is coming. We've heard that. Those of us that were raised in church, we've heard it all of our life. Lord's coming again. Lord's coming back. You better be ready. You better turn before you burn, whatever it is they want to say. You better be ready. But it hasn't happened yet, has it? I'm 53 years old. It ain't happened in my life. Is it going to happen in my life? Number two, it is unknown. We don't know. There's a lot of things in life. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. There's a lot of things that happen in life, and we don't know when it's going to happen. You may have gone to the doctor, and you've got that hitch in your get-along, and he says, you can take some pills, and you can do some therapy, but at some point in life, we're going to have to fix that. That ain't never going to go away, and you're going to have to do something about it. Now, that may be next month, next year, 5, 10, 15 years down the road. That just depends on how much hitch you want in that get-along. You're going to have to do something about that at some point. There's going to come a time when Jesus is going to come back from where he has prepared for us. When? I'm glad you asked. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, Paul is writing this to the church at Thessalonica. And what has happened in the church of Thessalonica is there are those that have started prophesying that it's coming on so and so and such day. They're saying, based upon some calculations that I've done, me being real smart, much smarter than you are, don't question my authority here, that the Lord is going to come back on such and such and so and such. So what Paul says is concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then suddenly destruction comes on them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. What he's saying is, they're telling you you're going to have peace and war breaks out. They're telling you you're going to have comfort and you think you're a woman in labor, you're hurting so bad. If they can't even predict how you're going to feel, how can they predict when the Lord's going to come back? Verse 4, but you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. Boy, that's gone by the wayside, hasn't it? But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet of the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with Him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. Have you ever had something stolen from you? Paul is saying, the Lord's going to come like a thief in the night. Has anybody ever stole something from you? I never will forget one time I had a blue truck and I had the wiper arms painted blue and the wiper blades covers painted blue and it was all the same color blue and I went somewhere and about halfway home I realized somebody stole my wiper arms off my truck and I said, you've got to be kidding me. I had driving lights and a boosted CB antenna and a bed mat. They didn't get none of that. They stole my wiper arm. So I had to take one off my dad's truck, and me and him were one-armers for a while. And I got so mad thinking, how dare they steal from me? Now, if I'd have known they was going to steal them from me, I'd have been sitting out there with a stick waiting on them. I'd have showed them you don't steal from me. But what Jesus is saying is, you would not consciously be stolen from would you? If you knew somebody was going to steal from you, and I'm not talking about they're starving and they got starving babies and they're doing whatever they can to feed themselves. I'm talking about some old so-and-so that ain't got a lick of sense, that's just doing it just to prove a point that they can do it, that they can take from you. If you knew they were going to steal from you, would you not stay awake and keep a watch out? Yet Paul said, the Lord is coming again. Don't be asleep. You know he's going to come like a thief in the night, yet you're laying down just calm as a cucumber stool because some fool told you he's coming at that day when he may actually come on this day. We whack our brain trying to figure out why all these things happened. Why did they steal my wiper blades? Why wasn't I watching? Why wasn't I looking out the window? Did I see any kind of warning signs about it? And I'm real diligent about trying to protect my stuff, yet Paul says, you're asleep. Jesus will come like a thief in the night. Just when you think you're asleep, you're at peace, you're at rest, everything's okay, nobody cares, we're not on guard, bam, that's when it happens. How many folks do we know that have left these walks of life just like this? They made plans for lunch today. They made plans for Christmas this year. They've got tickets to a New Year's Eve celebration. The rest of their life ahead of them. Jesus said, watch and be sober. Keep your eyes open. Look for opportunities. When you've got your eyes open, some of us can drive down the road and spot a pile of rusty something in the bushes all the way behind the barn down the neighbor's property. We can look for that kind of stuff, but we can't see souls right in front of us dying and going straight to hell. Keep your eyes open for an opportunity to share about somebody that's suffering, that may have a need. Look for opportunities, not distractions. Yeah, there may be something down behind the pasture in the hedge row behind the neighbor's property over there, but what about the guy you're talking to about it? Or the lady you're talking to about it? Is that an opportunity to share Jesus with somebody? Look for the pitfalls that ensnare us. You ever heard the phrase chasing rabbits? You turn your dog out and all he does is chase rabbits. The idea is for the dog to run the rabbit back by you so you can excommunicate him and have him for supper that night. But if all your dog does is run that rabbit plumb over to Winston County, what good is your dog? All he's done is run rabbits. You know, a lot of times we're like that dog. We get after something and we forget where home is. We forget what we're supposed to do. We can't hear the anymore to come back to us. We're just running, and man, we're doing such a good job running, and we're running so far away, we finally realize we don't even know where we are anymore. Because we were not awake. Aware. Aware means not drunk. Focus means not asleep. Be about what we were told to do. Now, one thing that gigs me in this, it's where he says in verse 9, God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Wrath is a strong, stern, or fierce anger, deep and resentful indignation, vengeance or punishment as a consequence of anger. Wrath brings judgment. Wrath brings separation. Wrath brings wrongful punishment, and that is not anything to do with obtaining salvation. Because when I'm bringing judgment against somebody, I'm pushing them away from me, and I may be the one that can tell them about Jesus Christ. When that wrath comes on me, it brings separation from that person, and I may be the one that may be able to tell them about Jesus Christ. I may be punishing somebody for something they never did. I might have blew up in the parking lot when I found out somebody stole my windshield wipers, and that poor little old lady over there didn't have a thing to do with it. Rather than bringing salvation and telling her about Jesus, I might have just run her off. I didn't do that. I was halfway home when I found out. But the resurrection is coming. We don't know when. And number three, it will be dramatic. It'll be dramatic. I've noticed here lately that when somebody wants to ask somebody to go to prom with them or go to homecoming with them or get engaged or whatever, they have to have this big dramatic flair. I mean, everybody's got to be in on it, but the poor person that doesn't realize what's happening, and the funniest ones, it's not funny if you're the person, is those that do that big production and get down on one knee and the person says no, or they just turn and run away or whatever, or they've already got a date or whatever it is. But everybody wants to be dramatic. I've got to outdo you, and outdid him, and outdid her. I've got to be the greatest thing and get all the wick walks and whatever it is put on there. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It's got to be dramatic. If it's not dramatic, nobody's going to remember it. If it's not dramatic, it's not going to be talked about. If it's not dramatic, I'm not going to get hits on my channel. It's got to be wow. When you ride a ride at the amusement park, if you got on the same roller coaster and it scared the stew out of you the first time, the second time it might scare less out of you. Before long, you've anticipated so much that that roller coaster no longer has any thrill for you. So what do? You go looking for a bigger one, badder one, faster one. If you jump off the cliff into the water and it doesn't break your neck, after you get over the rush, you think, I wonder if I went a little higher up if I can jump off and not break my neck. You see how we as a society, we want a little more, a little bigger, a little better, a little faster? Well, when Jesus comes again, it's going to be something this world has never seen before. And Paul wrote to the church at Corinth in chapter 15, and he said, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit corruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying which is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin. The strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Now I believe that when the Lord comes to the church, it's going to be very dramatic in the life of those He came for. And I believe that when the Lord comes for His church, and it's going to be very dramatic in the life of those that He comes after, it is not going to be dramatic for those that are left behind. Their ignorance is going to be so thick that they're not going to realize what's going on. You see, he says here, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Just because you're living and breathing, just because you've got flesh and blood coursing through your veins, does not guarantee you anything. You will not inherit the kingdom of God because flesh and blood are sinful. He talks about how death, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is in the law, because people can justify their actions according to the law. I'm a good person. I've never been arrested. I've never hung anybody or whatever it is. However you want to say it, I've never done something according to the law. That's flesh and blood. That's not going to be accepted. We have to be changed. Our mortal has to become immortal. Our corrupt has to be incorrupt. We must be change. Now I know what it's like when somebody gives their life to Jesus Christ. I've seen it. I've seen a 180-degree turn. I've seen people that before could cuss a sailor and make them leave blushed, stand on the street corner and tell someone about Jesus Christ and lead them to the Lord because they have been changed. And as radical and awesome and dramatic as that was, that ain't nothing compared to what we're going to be turned into. Now, I used to get to call my Aunt Christine on the way home just about every day. I started calling her after my mama went to be with the Lord. And my Aunt Christine lived over in Clebit, and she was kind of starting to lose some of her faculties, and I still just loved her to death. And the biggest thing she always asked me was, will I know Bill when I get to heaven? That was her husband, my Uncle Bill. She missed Uncle Bill so much. She missed Iris, her granddaughter-in-law that left these walks of life with a brain tumor. And she would ask me, will I know Bill? Will I know Iris? Will I know your daddy? Will I know any of those people when I get to heaven? We're going to be changed. We're going to become immortal. We're going to become incorruptible. All those things that we know are going to be gone. How am I going to know when I see my Bill in heaven? 1 Corinthians 13:12 says, now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. We will know each other, but we will not have a role or a tie. My wife will not be my wife in heaven. I will know her. I will know what we had, but those sinful fleshly desires will no longer be there. I will know my children, but I will no longer have authority over them as their father. We will all be the same in the sight of God. And it may be that I'll know who's not there. I don't know. I've talked about this a lot, the tear that'll be wiped from our eyes before we go into heaven. John already said there'll be no more crying. That tear is different from crying day to day. You see, death and resurrection are the same for a believer. There's no sting to death. It might hurt, but it's temporary. We may mourn the loss, but it's temporary. There's no victory for the grave. There may be a funeral, there may be a burial process, but it's temporary. It's only for a moment. Paul said, those who are asleep will rise first, and then those that are left will be changed in the twinkling of an eye, in a moment. And how many days have we said, Lord, come, and Lord, come quickly. I am sick and tired of this place. I'm tired of politicians that lie through their lips. And I'm tired of those people that tell me all these things just because they want something from me. And I'm tired of turning on the news and becoming angry. And I'm tired of the aches. And I'm tired of the pains. I'm tired of the hurts. I'm tired of the loneliness. I'm tired of missing all these things. Jesus, come quick. Yesterday at the Brotherhood breakfast, Brother Stanley Reeves and his wife, Miss Gloria, sang a song. And that song is called, Wait a Little Longer, Please, Jesus. Here the labor is so hard and the workers are so tired, and our weary hearts are longing for a rest. And we find we're getting anxious to be in that happy land where we'll enjoy some peace, happiness. But wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There's so many still a wonder how it's seen. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. Just a few more days to let our loved ones in. We may look into the skies and tears fill our eyes, for the weary hearts grow heavy with each day. First we cry, oh Lord, please come. Come and take your children home. And then we look around us and we say, wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There's so many still wandering out and see. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. Just a few more days to let our loved ones in. The family scattered here and there, but Lord, we love them dear. Maybe we can help them find a way. Well, if waiting is the cause, well, they may not be. Lord, that's the only reason why we say, wait a little longer, please, Jesus. So many wandering out in sin. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. Just a few more days to let our loved ones in.
We bought a gift. We may have wrapped it or had it wrapped with their name on it, slid under the tree, waited in anticipation to know it. Might be the right size, might be the right color, might be the right store. But have we ever thought about wrapping Jesus and handing him to him? You think about those that have gone on before us. Those that we know without a shadow of a doubt that they're in the kingdom of heaven. They're asleep in Abraham's bosom, as the Bible says. The holding pattern for when those go on, when the rapture happens, we'll leave Abraham's bosom, those that have gone on before. We'll all be together in heaven. Think about those that have gone on. Mamas, daddies, spouses, children, brothers, sisters, grandmas, grandpas. Think about getting to see them one day. But how many are going to be gathered around the Christmas tree this year that we won't see? I spent a lot of time buying you this shirt. I hope you like it. I put a lot of thought into buying that gift card to fill in the blank. I hope you can use it. I baked you some cookies. I hope you can eat them. You see, all that's very temporary. That shirt ain't going to heaven with them. Neither is that gift card. Neither are the cookies. Only that salt. How about I spend a lot of time thinking about how I can tell you about my Lord and my Savior? See, this season we celebrate His birth. You know why we celebrate His birth? Because He came to give us a gift of life. Life here and life hereafter. He came so that He could be our propitiation. The word Lydia loves to say. The propitiation is the sacrifice and all sacrifice. Once and done. And that gift, if you were to accept Jesus Christ, it's so simple. The Bible says if you believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, confess with your mouth that He is Lord and Savior of your life, you will be saved. You see how easy that was? I didn't break out the thick Bible. I didn't read 17 scriptures, and I just shared with you the plan of salvation. Do you know Jesus? Will I see you in heaven? I'll know you as you were known. I won't be your pastor. I won't be your husband or your father. I won't be your cousin. I won't be your brother. Whatever it is you know me as here, I'll just be one of those blessed to be seated around the throne of the mansion inside the mansion. Will I see you then? I could get you a nice shirt. I could buy you a gift card. I could get my wife to bake you some cookies. And then make you feel real good for a while. But I want you to feel real good forever. Is there anybody in your life you need to ask that to? Is there anybody in your life you suspect maybe they don't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior? So there's going to come a day. It's coming. Guaranteed. Write it down. Mark my words. It's coming. And I have no idea when. It may be it. 2:37 this afternoon, for all I know. We may be planning, I've got all the candles for the candlelight service tonight, and I might not even get to use. I had a chance to do a 1 year or 5 year on something. I said, boy, I hate to spend 5 years, because if the Lord comes back in year three, I've wasted all that extra money. I don't know. They looked at me like I was crazy, and I said, you do know the Lord comes back, right? You see how I rolled that into an invitation for that person? It's coming. It's going to be dramatic for me. I'm going to be changed. And I want everybody that I know to be changed too. I'm going to ask you to pray with me right now. I want you to just pray. God, put a face of somebody that may not know it. And it may be that they know it, but they're not living right. They're living with the devil as fast and hard as they can. God, if they don't know, give me the courage to share Jesus with them. God, if they're not where they want to be, Lord, convict me to live a life in front of them that they need to see. It'll draw them to you just like a bug to a life. those faces of those people we know. Do you love them? Do you like them? Do you at least know them? Do you want to stand before your Lord and Savior and say, yeah, I knew they were lost. I just didn't want to take the time. I figured it'd be better just buy them a shirt, give them a gift card, bake them some cookies, and get them out of my hair. Now for all eternity. This morning I'm going to ask you to be bold enough to pray God put them in front of me. God, give me a chance. One more chance, Lord. I know you're coming. I don't know when, and I know it's going to be some spectacular. Lord, help me to be able to drag as many with me as I can. I believe it was D.L. Moody said if they want to commit their life and soul to the pits of hell, let them have to leap over my body, jerking the fingernails out of my fingers because I'm so diligent. Would you say that? Father, our prayer this morning, God, is as you spoke to our hearts. Lord, we've heard a lot of things that's going to happen. Father, I know it's easy for the human to doubt that they really will. Father, you said you're coming again. God, you said you've gone to make a place and you're coming again. Father, we know that you're coming, but we don't know when, because you said you'll come like a thief in the night. Ain't no night like that going to clue us in. Father, we know it's going to be something else to see ourselves change, to become immortal. God, to become incorrupt. Father, to have those demons that we face in our mind never to haunt us again. Father, I lift up personally to you, those in my life that listen to those demons. Father, they think that it's just a fairy tale. And they really think they've got the rest of their life. That on their deathbed, with their last drawn breath, they can say, forgive me. You'll all be okay. God, I pray for those faces that are in my heart, in my mind. Those that you put in front of me every day. God, I pray for the courage and the strength, the Holy Spirit to anoint when we share it. Father, this morning, as we commit these names and these faces to you, Lord, I pray that you move. God, the only way God can move in the life of these people. Some of them, God, we need to pray whatever it takes. Get their attention, Lord. You've got to break them in half, Lord, if it means they get saved, so be it. God, I know that's going to hurt. It's going to be tough to pray for. Your word says it's better to leave this life partial than to burn in hell cold. I'm going to ask you to stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. You come on down the altar and start praying about whoever that is. God's put in your life. You pray, God, give me an opportunity. God,
we
God, I pray that we're not